We are in Nashville in the summer of 1960. The guitarist Grady Martin and the producer Glenn Snoddy are at work in this studio, the Owen Bradley's Quonset Hut. Grady Martin is playing at an electro tic-tac six-string bass for the song Don't Worry About Me by Marty Robbins.
Don't worry about me.
Don't Worry is just a common slick country ballad. Probably not many outside of the US would remember it today if it weren't for a strange technical accident that would dramatically affect the music of the following decades. A preamp transformer in the mixing desk of the studio had a technical failure and recorded the bass track with an unexpected harsh distortion. Grady Martin and Glenn Snoddy were expert studio guys and did not lose heart. They got the idea to keep that weird, fart-sounding distortion in the final master recording. So, in the sappy country ballad, at one point abruptly erupts a heavily distorted bass solo, completely out of context and quite unorthodox, especially for the time. Glenn Snoddy's bold decision proved to be successful. Don't Worry hit number 3 on the pop chart in 1961. Fuzzy tone was the term coined to describe that new sound. But actually, that was not the first time that a distorted signal would deliberately get on record. Let's step back to 1949, more than 10 years earlier. By the audio production rules, a distorted sound is a technical mistake, strictly considered an unsuitable corrupted signal. But did you know what Albert Einstein said? Everyone knew it was impossible until a fool who didn't know came along and did it. In this case, the fool was the 18 years old black guitarist Gary Carter from Houston. When he recorded Rock a While, he used an overdriven guitar sound, surprisingly anticipating of quite a few years the style of Chuck Berry. The single is considered the first rock and roll record ever.
Feeling good this morning, I feel like I wanna rock a while.
Sam Phillips, founder of the sound recording studio in Memphis, would also soon become confident about the distorted sound. Phillips, in 1950, produced the woman band Joe Hill Lewis, who recorded Boogie in the Park with an outrageous cranked-up guitar. The following year, Sam Phillips recorded Racket 88, played by 19-year-old Ike Turners and his Kings of Rhythm. While the band was driving from Clarksdale, Mississippi to the studio in Memphis, the car had a flat tire. In a rush to grab the spare tire, the guitar amplifier fell from the trunk, and then it was poorly repaired. That's how the guitar player Willie Kidzart got one of the earliest distorted guitar tones in history. The recording, released in April 1951 on Chess Records, was unfortunately credited to Ike Turner's saxophonist Jackie Branston. The single hit number 1 on the R&B charts and is now regarded as the first successful rock and roll record. More distorted tones came from African-American electric blues guitar players of the time, such as Guitar Slim, Willie Johnson, who was Howlin' Wolf's guitar player during the early days in Memphis, and Pat Hare, guitar player of the James Cotton Band. There's this funny anecdote. Guitar Slim was in a grocery store, and he heard an announcement from the PA sounding distorted. He liked the sound so much that he convinced the owner of the store to sell him the amplification system. Allegedly, that's what he used in 1953 to record with his Les Paul Gold Tap the things that they used to do. The single sold more than a million copies and became a standard listed in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame among the most influential songs of all time. The following year, the guitarist Pat Hare recorded at the Sun Studio Cotton Crop Blues by James Cotton and his own cover of I'm Gonna Murder My Baby. He used distinctive, heavily distorted power chords.
I'm gonna murder my baby, 'cause she don't do nothing but cheat and lie.
Incidentally, in I'm Gonna Murder My Baby, Pat Hare was not joking at all. A few years later, he actually shot his girlfriend dead and spent the rest of his days in prison, where it seems that he played in a band named Sounds Incarcerated. In 1955, Chuck Berry impressed the world with the sonic impact of his debut single, Maybelline.
Can't you be true?
In 1956, Grady Martin himself, 4 years before the recording of Marty Rubin's Don't Worry, created one of the most distorted riffs of the early rock and roll. He played rhythm guitar on The Train Kept A-Rollin' in the Johnny Burnett Rock and Roll Trio. 1958 was the time for another great innovator. Link Wray considered the link between the early blues guitarists and the guitar heroes of the 1960s. Wray was pioneering heavily distorted sounds in his live performances. When he went to record the instrumental Rumble, he was feeling frustrated as he could not properly recreate his live tone in the studio. Wray did not lose heart, took a pan and pierced the speakers of the resident amplifier. That's how he achieved an unprecedented, in-your-face, anti-establishment guitar tone, still sounding stunningly modern today. The attitude of his power chords had an evocative force that made Rumble the only instrumental piece ever banned from radio in the United States. The producer Lee Hazelwood said in an interview that to get guitar distortion, he simply pulled out a power tube out of the amp. That's probably what he did in March 1960 when he recorded Go On Home by rockabilly legend Stanford Clark, backed by the guitar player Al Casey. We are now back to summer 1960. After more than 10 years of illustrious predecessors in sound distortion. So why the fuzzy tone created in Nashville by the sound engineer Glenn Snoddy was so special? Until then, guitar distortion was achieved with valve or tube amplifiers. The power rating declared by the manufacturers of the time was intended for undistorted power output. The AC30, for instance, was declared for an output power of 30 watts undistorted. This means that the signal achieved above this threshold was not considered really suitable or recommended. The pioneers of the guitar distortions from the 50s usually pushed the volume to exceed the capability of their amplifiers to handle clean signals. The bass solo in Don't Worry sounded similar to a distortion type generated by a solid-state circuit. Valve or tube distortion generally sounds warm, round, and relatively mellow. Snoddy's fuzzy tone sounded more aggressive, coarse, and edgy, with a deliberate scoop in the mid-frequencies. A solid state circuit can push the signal well above the distortion threshold. The extra signal, which is beyond the capability of the amplifier, is just cut off or clipped. The clipping results in a deformation of the natural sine waveform of the signal. The rounded tops and bottoms of the wave are cut off flat, so the clipped signal becomes a square waveform. Short of nerdy speech, Grady Martin's bass solo sounded unlike anything heard in the past. Before the bed transformer definitely quit functioning, Martin also rushed an instrumental song named The Fuzz, where his distorted bass line backs up an orchestral arrangement. When Marty Robbins' Don't Worry reached the top of the charts in 1961, many musicians and sound technicians started to desire that fuzzy sound in their recordings. The Californian pedal steel player and expert technician Red Rhodes came to a solution. He developed a solid-state circuit that would be known as the first fuzz box. The device was never marketed. Rhodes only built a handful of these units for close friends and fellow musicians, and gave one to the session guitar player Bill Strange. Strange used this early fuzz unit in the recording of I Just Don't Understand by chartbreaker Ann Margaret.
I just don't understand.
For what matters, Margaret also figured in a chart of the 100 hottest women of all time. Her soapy ballad has surprisingly gone down in history, remembered as the first recording ever made with a proper fuzzbox unit. Actually, the fuzz was used rather randomly and still sounded quite out of context. Another fuzz unit, handmade by Red Rhodes, ended up in the hands of Nuki Edwards, lead guitarist of California surf band The Ventures. The band used it in 1962 in the recording of the single 2000 Pound Bee. The combination between the fuzz and the energetic surf rock and roll of The Ventures sounds definitely more interesting and on track than anything produced before. 2000 Pound Bee is remembered as the first rock and roll record with a fuzz pedal, finally used for artistic expressive purposes with good taste and tone awareness. The fuzz guitar was starting to define its natural territory. That same year, Phil Spector produced Zippa-de-Duda by Bob B. Sucks and the Blue Jeans, a vocal band backed by session musicians from the Wrecking Crew Collective. A fuzzy guitar solo was incidentally achieved with an unusual placement of the microphones. Meanwhile, Glenn Snoddy did not stand idly by. He studied his own way to replicate the fuzzy tone he created on Don't Worry and patented a circuit based on three germanium transistors. The enclosure box had a switch on top to engage or bypass the effect. The first guitar pedal, or stomp box of the history, was created. Snoddy presented his invention to Gibson and sealed a deal. In 1962, Gibson launched, under the Maestro brand, Snoddy's pedal with the name of Fuzz-Tone FZ1. Sold at a price of $40, it was the first fuzz pedal on the market. The effect was also made available as a built-in module in some bass models, including Gibson EBOF and Epiphone Newport EBSF. In 1962, more than 5,000 pedals were produced in the Kalamazoo factory. The distributors and sales network welcomed with enthusiasm the innovative device, and in prevision of a great commercial success, took up all of them. Unfortunately, these optimistic expectations would be disappointed. Gibson released a demonstration record.
It's mellow, it's raucous, it's tender, it's raw, it's the maestro Fuzz-Tone. You have to hear this completely different sound effect for the guitar to believe it. It opens a whole new world of music for you. Instantly, with Fuzz-Tone, you can create guitar sounds never before heard.
It was a one-sided 7-inch, 33 RPM vinyl in which they tried to figure out how the FZ-1 could be used and captivate the interest of musicians.
Organ-like tones, mellow woodwinds and whispering reeds, booming brass and bell-clear horns, plus many, many more.
The Fuzz-Tone was misrepresented as some sort of guitar synth forerunner that could emulate brass or bowed instruments.
Here's a surprise. We're playing guitar, but the sound is trumpet.
Players didn't bother. Understandably, they didn't want their guitar to sound like a carnival trumpet. It's no wonder that most of the units produced in 1962 remained crowding up the shelves of warehouses and stores. The following year, only 3 units left the factory, and not even one in 1964. The Fuzz pedal appeared in a few songs, such as a couple of tunes by PJ Proby, but didn't really catch on. Dave Davies, guitar player of the Kinks, probably didn't even know of the new Fuzz-Tone pedal. When the band recorded in the UK the groundbreaking You Really Got Me, Davies achieved a great distortion, adopting a variation on Link Ray's method. He pierced with a knitting needle the speaker of a small tube combo and reamped it on a Vox AC30. The standoff situation of the Maestro FZ-1 got a sudden and radical turnaround in May 1965. The Rolling Stones unleashed the relentless riff of I Can Get No Satisfaction. Keith Richards gives credit to the producer, Andre Lug Holdem, for bringing the Fuzz up front in the mix, finally in a prominent position. The Fuzz-Tone shaped the anthem of anger, dissatisfaction and frustration of a whole generation, and became the voice of a new rock counterculture movement. The revolution of Fuzz had begun. In the next episode, we will continue to follow the evolution of Fuzz-Tone pedals through music and culture of the 60s. Please make sure you subscribe to the BTR channel and click the bell to keep posted. Thank you for your feedback, comments and support. They help the BTR channel to keep going and our community of guitar friends to grow. Please feel free to join our Facebook group and come to visit us on Instagram.